I go outside, there's nothing to do. What do we do?
Detroit.
Not much to report today in Phil Spector news. Other than I guess he's just out there.
Well, that's the main thing. In fact, got a body sitting right there. You got the weapon. You got the guy that probably did it. And
you got $1 million.
Yeah, $1 million bucks, and you put all that together, and now boom, Mike, you're gone. You're sprung. You're out there.
Can we put credit where credit's due?
All right, we believe
he's gone 48 hours without murdering anyone. So we could.
That's a plus.
Certainly celebrate that.
That's a plus. That's Shapiro. He'll come up with a dream team. I'm sure they'll hire some tremendous jury consultant, and we'll watch the whole process occur right in front of our face.
I don't think it'll be easy, though.
It won't be easy, but
I like that there's not a lot of information out there. That tells me that this one's going to be maybe a little more airtight, which should benefit the, is this LAPD?
Well, I hope we don't have contaminated.
It's not LAPD, is it? Well, yeah, suburban LA home, so it probably is, and that's too bad. Anyway, we found out yesterday that Lana Clarkson, the 41-year-old woman that he killed, beautiful girl, by the way.
Yeah.
Was in Scarface, Fast Times at Ridgemont High, Barbarian Queen, Roger Corman's movies. She's quite nude on her website, which is it LanaClarkson.com? Yeah. She is a beautiful woman.
Nude.
Very nude.
Wow, is she nude.
And looks pretty good in some of these pictures, I have to say.
No question.
I think she sold pictures of herself, too. Sadly, her career was not exactly on fire. I think she was working the door at the House of Blues. If you're going to work the door, I guess that's a good place to work the door. But somehow, the idea of someone 41 years old, although still very attractive, seeking fortune in Los Angeles and Hollywood, and ending up at Phil Spector's house.
Yeah.
It's 5 in the morning.
Oh.
A gun-waving lunatic, 62 years old, with a bad toupee. Somehow, that's just not how it's supposed to end when you go to Hollywood, is it?
Jeez. What a horrible story.
Yeah, I know. It's pretty grim.
What a terrible story.
Well put, I might say.
Oh, that sums it up entirely. Let's just hope we don't start the thing off with a contaminated crime scene.
Oh, I'm sure you'll have that. You'll also hear what a crazy slut Lana Clarkson is, which is really sad.
Oh, the character assassination will be huge.
Yeah. Well, I'm curious to hear what they have. Although,
and
if they don't tell us, that's probably for the better.
Well, I don't know how they're going to paint him to be a perfectly stable individual either.
Oh, they won't be able to do that.
No, they certainly won't.
Although his ex-wife, who he treated like a prisoner, is now testifying in his favor on Good Morning America yesterday, which was one of the most ridiculous things I've ever seen.
Disgusting.
Having read her book, which, by the way, I'm getting a copy of it today, and I can't wait to see all the horrific things she said about him, which she now is retracting, apparently. So I guess she'll be giving back her advance to the publisher. Hey, Ken, you got kicked out of a casino last night? Which casino?
Greektown Casino.
And what were you playing?
$25 blackjack.
Oh, they're kicking you out for playing blackjack?
Yeah, unfortunately they did.
Okay, what did you win?
You know what? I went to the Wings game last night, and after we stopped at Greektown about 2 hours of playing $25 blackjack, I was up about probably right around $6,000.
You're kidding me!
In 2 hours?
Yeah, it was one of those nights.
Oh my God!
And okay, you went to the Wings game. You're there a couple hours. This is just the cop in me. Was there much consumption of alcohol going on?
You know what? Not enough to where I was obnoxious to the point they said I was causing a disturbance.
No. Yeah, I was wondering why were you kicked out? Yeah.
Have you ever won that much money before?
Not in one night. No.
How excited were you?
You know what? I was pretty excited, but I'm smart enough to know that it can go pretty quick too. So I wasn't jumping around or.
Yeah, you've played.
You sit there playing this game. You're up $6,000 and everything.
You should be excited. There's nothing wrong with being a little excited. It's just that if you're bombed and you're spilling drinks and then I think that you can give them grounds to throw a hot gambler out. But I'm just appalled at this casino that you start winning and hey, that's not, you're supposed to lose in our casino.
Yeah, because you're sitting there and you're up $6,000, and then what happens? What's the sequence of events? Somebody shows up standing next to you in a suit or what?
You know what? As I was winning, I was putting the money I was winning in my pocket, and I was keeping in front of me a little bit of a slush fund.
The chips?
Yes.
Okay. How much in chips did you have in your pockets?
I had a sack full of hundreds in there.
Okay. All
right. And about before I knew it, the guy behind me just taps me on the shoulder. I turn around, and he's like, "Sir, I'm going to have to ask you to leave." And I was sitting at none of my friends were there. I was there with a buddy of mine who wasn't playing. He was at somewhere else. And everyone at the table was like, "What are you talking about?" Because you get in that rhythm with a bunch of people there, and we were all...
Yeah, you got a table. Other people are winning at the table, too?
Exactly.
Wow.
And they're like, sir, you're causing a disturbance. And I'll tell you guys, I never left my seat. I never pounded on the table. I mean, I was happy when I was winning, but I wasn't loud or yelling. And I was like, what are you talking about?
So by now he's got you pulled away from the table, probably.
He escorted me to the cashier. I cashed in my checks, and they escorted me out.
You know what? Why don't you call the one of the TV stations? Who would be most likely? I think anybody would bite on that. Yeah, Scott Lewis or somebody.
Oh, Fox would be all over that.
Yeah, why don't you try Fox, too? Call the news desk and see if they'll bite on that. You know, the neat thing would be if Greektown would actually cough up the video so we could see what this disturbance is. You know this is on videotape, so if they won't show us the videotape, then it's pretty clear they just don't like people winning there.
Well, did you guys hear that there was some story about them kicking people out for winning on video poker?
Yeah, they felt the people had learned the system, and I think their rationale was it works great for the 99% of the people, but the 1% that win way too much make it impossible for the other people to win money because they'd have to discontinue the game or something, or I don't know, or the jackpots would have to be reduced. But nonetheless, the idea of kicking someone out of a casino for winning is so comical, considering the house has it so far in their advantage. I mean, to me, that just tells me you ought to shut your doors if you have to kick people out for winning. Why don't you call the TV station?
I'll see what I can do.
Let me know what happens. Would you do that?
I sure will.
Okay, thanks.
Unbelievable.
Wow.
Oh, man.
Hey, Eric?
Yep.
How you doing, man?
Hey, how are you?
Good. What's up?
Yeah, they were just talking about anybody that ever saw Millen at a Red Wing game.
Yeah.
And I saw him. I sat next to him right behind or at the first game of the Stanley Cup playoffs.
Oh, so he comes for the playoffs. I don't know if that's good or bad. Well, you know, it's good. If he's showing up somewhere, I think that's good. You know, I stand corrected.
You'll love this, though. The guy sat there, and everybody was pounding on him, saying, you know, this is what a team should be doing. And when people would jump up when the Wings would score, he still sat there and didn't get up.
Oh, really?
Then all the Fox TV guys that were filming it for ESPN kept coming over to him and talking to him. And he's talking to them and chatting with them, but he wouldn't talk to anybody else.
Mm. That's too bad. Because, you know, there's some really nice people that are coaches in the state. You know, Dave Lewis, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Seems like the kind of guy to shake your hand if you bumped into him somewhere. Well, Rick Carlisle, too. I think Carlisle's made himself part of the community.
Look at the fans, too.
Lloyd Carr and Tom Izzo.
Look how loyal the fans are. You know what I mean?
You know, the other thing was, he obviously had no pull with the Red Wings because we sat in the upper bowl in the eighth row. So he never even got lower bowl seats, so he must not have too many friends down at the Red Wings.
Who was he with? Who was he at the game with?
He was with, it looked like his son and maybe his son's girlfriend.
Okay, so his kid probably made him go.
Yeah, right. Maybe he wanted to be way up there, though. Maybe he wanted to be a little incognito or something.
Well,
get way up there away from the main crowds.
In his defense, if you're 2-14 or whatever he was last year, I don't know how visible you want to be. It'd be a lot easier to go out when you're 8-8 or 10-6.
But you should shake somebody's hand.
Thanks for the call, though. Yeah, you should be polite, that's a drag. Hey, Jason.
Hey, how's it going, guys?
Not bad.
You guys talking about firefighters earlier, you know? My buddy doesn't wear a T-shirt, but he shows his badge everywhere we go.
Well, that was, somebody emailed about this, because Mike was saying, boy, this Ryan guy in Bachelorette sure wears his firefighter shirt everywhere, and somebody said that these three guys he works out with wear them all the time, and someone emailed said I'm a firefighter, and one of the reasons I wear my shirt everywhere is because I'm ready to go if he gets called to a... Although, do you get called from the mall?
Well,
from the workout center? I guess you get beeped, maybe.
Well, we're also talking about just a T-shirt.
Yeah.
This guy
really
shows his badge, though.
Well,
I mean, he's got 10 shots of Jaeger in him. He's walking around showing his badge.
Well, yeah.
That's unfortunate.
Yeah.
Well, 10 shots of Jaeger sounds like he's going to catch fire.
All this started really just based on the fact that just Ryan. You know what I mean?
Firefighters have been doing calendars for a long time. Chicks have been into firefighters for a while, but that is...
Well, we're talking about, too, if the shirt can get you places with the chicks.
Why not? I just realized Arsenio's calling in a few minutes. Let's find out about this Tonguejoy, this tonguing device.
Yeah.
That supposedly Carrie Fisher bought two of at the Adult Video Awards.
Stank.
Hello?
Bill.
Yeah.
Hey, Bill, Drew and Mike, WRIF Radio.
How are you guys doing?
Good. How's the Tonguejoy business?
It's doing great.
Did you get some orders from
Detroit? It's coming, so they're going like hotcakes.
Did you get some orders from Detroit?
We sure did.
Did you? I thought you would.
Good. A lot of them?
People calling in delighted.
Yeah? I wonder what if they're ordering from the for the girls, or, of course, the girls use them on the men as well, right?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Equal opportunity toy.
Yeah? Does it feel good, Bill?
Oh, my goodness. in fact, Tracy and I just played with it day before yesterday. And
wow.
Like, oh, man.
That's pretty hot.
Yeah.
And it is, of course, dishwasher friendly. I think we covered that.
Right.
Did we not?
Dishwasher friendly.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, but my pointing up, given the fact that you like to use it on your butt, Bill.
What's that? What happened now?
I'm sorry?
Oh, I don't know. Don't I think we lost something there.
Yeah.
Anyway. We just read about Carrie Fisher buying not one, but two Tonguejoys.
Yes, she did.
Why two?
Because she's a smart woman.
Because in case one goes bad or she...
No, so that they both can use it.
Oh, I see. Did you guys talk to her about all the nerve endings in the man's buttocks?
It does do that.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, take it from you, huh, Bill?
Take it from me.
Yeah.
Were you guys there when she bought it?
Yeah, I actually sold it to her.
And what does she want to know?
Basically, she didn't really need to know much. She's, like I said, she's very intelligent, and she just wanted to know if it worked, and we smiled, and she says, I can tell by the smiles on your faces that it works, and that if you had two, that you could obviously both play at the same time. Then she went,
And I see you gave her a discount, too, didn't you? At least that's what the story said.
Yeah, we did. We gave her a twofer deal. It was at the LA Erotica, and she was just going through to see what all the hoopla was about, and came by our booth. And so when we were at the shows, we do promotional things, and we did a twofer thing. I think we sold her two for $120.
Did she want to know if it was dishwasher safe? Did she ask that question? Or?
No, she didn't. We talked a little bit about her book, Postcards from the Edge, and that was it.
Oh.
How many big porn stars bought it?
Most all of them are very familiar with them.
Like Jenna Jameson or any of the big ones come up and buy it?
Jameson bought one, and in fact, one of them, and I'm not real good with the names, but at the AVN show I was there, and this lady came up to me, and she knelt down in front of me and bowed like I was a pharaoh and just said, thank you, thank you, thank you.
That's hot. That's hot. She knows all about nerve endings.
You know, someone gets on their knees in front of you at an AVN show, you don't know what's going to happen next.
Any chance of Carrie Fisher being offered a job as spokesperson for Tonguejoy?
If she wants the job, she can help.
I don't know how that story got out, so I don't think she probably would want
to. Well, it sounds like she went to the tabloids and got herself a little publicity.
It could be.
I mean, what's wrong with being a purchaser of Tonguejoy?
She's a wild one.
Absolutely nothing.
Did you ever nail down whether Lee Majors has a Tonguejoy or not? Because it seems to me that we were debating whether he did, and you kind of thought he did.
Well, you know what? Joey Travolta, who was the director, I gave him one, and I know that he hassled Lee about it.
Joey loves it, doesn't he?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Puts
it in his butt.
Oh, God, yes. Of course.
That's hot. What's the number to buy Tonguejoy?
1-877-456-7742.
And there's a website, too.
Yes, tonguejoy.com.
Wow. Any other celebrity endorsements you guys have had besides Joey Travolta, who I guess goes crazy with the damn thing, and Princess Leia?
At the Hustler store in Sunset, we were in visiting those folks just kind of to talk to the salespeople. We were out there on a show anyway, and so they said it was a hot seller for them and that Christina Aguilera came in, and they actually closed the store. She came in with her bodyguard.
Wait, she'd have to close the store so she can buy sex toys?
You
that seems kind
that.
Of silly.
And she bought only one thing, and that was the Tonguejoy.
It's the perfect gift if no one has ever had a toy.
Yeah.
It's the perfect introductory gift.
I'm sure she's had toys for years.
Are you kidding?
21.
Oh, God, you know it.
Those of you listeners who are out there who've never experienced the enjoyment of a vibrator, it is so small yet feels so good, they're able to enjoy their first toy.
Yeah.
And put it right on your tongue.
Or for the guys, too. Hey, this is a great thing for Valentine's Day coming up. I hadn't even thought about that.
There you go.
What better, what more romantic thing to give to a woman or to your guy with all the nerve endings down there than a Tonguejoy?
Get it or give it as a gift. It'll be the most intriguing gift you ever exchange.
You know, for a Jenna Jameson, for example, who's been certainly, at the very least, overactive in terms of sexuality, is there like an XL version of this thing? Or is it not used for that?
You turn up. But it, you get the same one that she got.
You do.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not really used for that. It's not for It's not used as an insertion thing. It's a...
Yeah, external.
Yeah, it's external.
Yeah, yeah.
External. External or insertion. It works both ways.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, except in Bill's case. It's frequently internal,
well,
you know.
Well, I'm a crazy guy.
Well,
yeah.
Bill, I don't know, but we don't know that Bill only likes it externally.
Oh, yeah, you know.
I don't know. He's never stated as such.
He's come to new heightened experiences.
Oh, yeah. So hot.
He likes his rim buffed. You like your rim buffed a time or two, don't you, Bill?
I love it all, man.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you something. I love to, for people out there who have toe fetishes or foot fetishes,
mm-hmm.
My feet were so sore at one of the conventions, I decided to put it on my big toe. All of a sudden, I'm just in ecstasy. I couldn't imagine, my God, how good it felt on my foot.
God, is that beautiful.
Man, that's sweet. Amazing.
Tonguejoy.com. Is there time for Valentine's Day if somebody gets an order in today
or
tomorrow?
In fact, probably if they ordered in the next day or so, even surface delivery would get in there. We have them in stock. And
what will the return address say?
It'll just say JJK Industries.
Okay.
No one will know what it is.
Perfect.
To come to your work, to take to your bride, or whatever you want to do.
All right. We'll look forward to hopefully you getting a lot of orders for Valentine's Day. Thanks for the info on Carrie Fisher. That's pretty hot there.
Thank you.
Very fun.
You guys have fun.
And
all right.
Bye-bye. Valentine's Day and have lots of romantic vibrations.
Thanks a lot.
Bye.
Bye. All right.
Yeah.
So, Bill, again, emphasizing what a collection of nerve endings this guy has.
God almighty, it's unstoppable. Well, that couple, they're always together, aren't they?
Yeah.
Always.
You can't split them apart. Well, they've got their own tongue joys, so they're always working on each other.
I know they are. Boy, Bill does dig it, doesn't he?
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, man, oh, man.
Oh, come on, can you blame him?
Jeez.
He was falling asleep during that whole interview until you mentioned that.
He was right
in the conversation.
Yeah, he keeps it with him like a rabbit's foot. In his pocket day in and day out.
Do you think when she's doing that to him, just going to town on his a-hole?
Yeah,
she's got it in her hand or her mouth.
Both. Both. She's probably got one in her tongue, one in her finger.
Yeah, they've got them laying around. They got dozens of them laying around.
She has them everywhere you can put one. She has one.
Every time you open up their dishwasher, there's like eight of them in there.
Oh, I know it. I know.
Because Bill's butt just demands one like every 2 hours.
Oh, yeah, it's all in with the silverware. It's in that silverware basket all piled in there. Yeah, right.
Don't you wonder what Carrie Fisher's making of all this?
Oh, I know it.
She's just got to be
isn't that
slightly
something?
Bummed.
Isn't that something?
Mm-hmm.
Jeez, look at these people.
The funny thing is, Bill doesn't know how it got out.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know.
He probably called the media himself.
Well, come on. Do you think Carrie Fisher told somebody?
Yeah, right. Huh, as if. Well, Detroit has checked in, huh? Selling quite a few.
Carrie Fisher got two of them?
That's right.
Which means she wants to use it on somebody's butt?
That's right. If you get two, that means you're planning on a butt.
Let's take advantage of those nerve endings.
That's right. If you get two, you are planning on some butt action.
Tonguejoy.com. 1-877-456-7742.
Drew and Mike.
It's Circus Freak Show.
Okay. It's Circus Freak Show.
101 WRIF. The Riff. Drew and Mike on 101 WRIF Detroit.
9:04. We're waiting on Arsenio Hall, who is
late.
And apparently they're having trouble locating him. Unless this is him. Is that Mr. Stress, do you think?
It's probably Stress.
Okay. Yeah, I believe it is. Traffic's brought to you by Motor City Pit Stop. Motor City Casino's newest dining option with authentic homestyle barbecue, just the way you like it. Hot and messy. Just how good barbecue should be at Motor City Casino. That's the Motor City Pit Stop Barbecue. Hey, Stress, what's going on?
Hey, sorry to disappoint you. I'm not Arsenio.
No, it's okay. I'd rather it was you.
I could pretend to be him.
No, it's okay.
All right.
I don't need my ass kissed today. Just kidding.
75 stop on at Rochester Road. Big old accident there all over the shoulders. Debris field everywhere. Everything backed up. Everybody fed up. 696 westbound before Woodward Avenue. Big accident there. Both left lanes are blocked. And that thing is stopped all the way past I-75. What an enormous pain in the ass. Then Gratiot at 7 Mile Road. Traffic lights aren't working worth a damn. So naturally that's backed up all directions because of that. The rest is construction. Oh, and then, of course, Hines Drive, you know. Flooded. Of course, you know the routine. That's a hell of traffic.
Yeah, it's funny, the nickname Askissio, because I was watching this retrospective on his late night show. And he got in a lot of battles on that thing.
Really?
He fought with Madonna. He fought with Damon Wayans. He fought with Vanilla Ice. One of the Milli Vanilli guys wanted to fight him.
Yeah. Oh, come on.
Yeah.
Air fight him, though.
I guess so. But
I mean, more so than, you don't see Letterman getting in real fights with people, although he does push the edge a lot.
Well, like Madonna, that was a big fight.
Wasn't Arsenio sort of pushing the envelope at the time, though?
Yeah,
where now
yeah,
he'd
he
probably
was.
Be, you know, kind of in there with the rest of them, but.
Well, yeah, I suppose, although not Jay. Jay never gets into it.
No, not Jay. Jay's very easy.
We may get interrupted by Arsenio. He's unlocatable at this point, but he may turn up for his first interview. Meanwhile, you're brought to us by the new family of Chrysler Sebrings. They resonate performance and sophistication. My words, I'm ad-libbing on this one.
Really?
Visit your Chrysler and Jeep Superstore today to check out their great lease rates. From the sedan to the coupe to the convertible, the new family of Chrysler Sebrings.
Day may come when you will not be able to go have a beer after work and drive home because your blood alcohol level could put you in jail.
I drive a Dodge Stratus!
For drunk driving. In Michigan and about 14 other states fighting for our right to party a little, the state is trying to avoid the feds bumping down the legal level of alcohol in your blood. 0.01 is the level now to be legally drunk while driving. The feds are pressuring heavily for it to be lowered to 0.08.
Alcohol increases your ability to drive.
The level for driving while impaired, 0.05. It's now 0.07, which restaurants and bars say would kill nightlife in the city.
Parking lot would be a parking lot. Nobody can start their car. Would that be hilarious? At 2 a.m., yeah. There's like 100 cars. None of them will start.
Imagine a Silverdome parking lot after a Lions game at the Silverdome.
80,000 cars. Going. What would it sound like to have 80,000 cars all going?
That's a tough battle, too, because if Michigan doesn't cave in, the feds are going to deprive the state of $11.6 million in road repair fund, something we really desperately need. Resistance has cost us so far $23 million. And on the other hand, there are the people who say, if you're drunk and you're not paying attention or you're being irresponsible because you've had too much to drink, then you could kill people. It's a good argument for a shuttle service of some kind, or at least some kind of transportation for people in bar areas, but that even...
We need cabs in this town.
That hasn't even been breached.
It's so true.
Come on.
Like Chicago and all that. That's amazing.
Yeah,
you go to those cities.
Isn't it bizarre?
I know, it really is, because... Yeah,
but it says, take a cab. Where's the cab?
I know.
Yeah, you can't get one.
Because I started going to Chicago like a few years ago, and there they are. Cabs everywhere.
Sometimes when you do, you're not quite sure you're going to get home.
Oh, man.
It's kind of scary, or they're kind of run down.
It takes 45 minutes to get one. Somewhere like Royal Oak. Royal Oak should be teeming with cabs.
Oh,
I think people would take them.
No, they would, if it was commonplace to have cabs all over the place.
Sitting around waiting for a cab. What do? You drink more.
Exactly.
So you're drunker.
You ever walk around Royal Oak at like 2:15 in the morning? There are cops everywhere.
Oh, yes.
I mean, they're just circling
crawling.
The blocks.
Oh, crawling.
We called a cab from Riley, one of Riley's New Year's parties.
Uh-huh.
He came over, got bombed, woke up
the
couch the next morning. We called another cab to take us home.
Oops. Oops.
That's pretty funny. Oh, brother.
So it's like TV just got sick of trying to deliver good family programming and caved in to crank out more sex. More sex, more risky sex, more racks. The percentage of shows depicting or implying sexual intercourse, according to this latest study, spiked from 10 to 14% over the last 2 years.
I think it'd be more than that, even.
Well, thank God we have something like Fear Factor, which
is
really family fun.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You mean Rack Factor?
Rack Factor.
It's Colin Powell's big show this morning at the UN, the junket to justify the war against Iraq, where he's going to take some audio that the CIA has, they claim, was intercepted from Iraqi scientists talking to each other about hiding things. Two new designs are up for perusal to replace the World Trade Center towers in New York City. The final offerings are either really interesting and cool, will be the tallest buildings in the world, or stupid, depending on who you ask in New York City. The one of them, did you see the pictures of them?
Mm-mm.
Topped by scaffolded glass, almost, is what it looks like. Like there's a giant, really tall cage on top of it. Apparently, that is what they're calling, the designers calling, the aerial gardens. They would have offices below it and then this big glass enclosure, which would have plants and gardens inside.
September 11th, major fight because John left the table early.
Whatever it is, the final design is supposed to be picked at the end of this month. Courtney Love admits her child, Frances Bean Cobain, thinks mommy has a potty mouth. It's her way of defusing the whole arrest snafu at Heathrow Airport yesterday. When she, according to Virgin Atlantic, verbally attacked a flight attendant. On this flight from L.A. to London, she apparently wondered why a woman who was in economy was being such a bitch about her friend coming from economy to first class. She wondered why the flight attendant had to be a bitch about it. and that's why they took her off the plane. Although,
why do you tell them I didn't do nothing, Mom? No, you tell them.
God.
Virgin, however, says, or another witness on Virgin, the airline's flight that she was on, says she was spewing expletives and swinging at the staff.
Well, again, get her off a plane. Don't let her on a plane. Is that Richard Branson's airline?
Yeah. Virgin.
She'll get off the hook. It's a music guy.
Oh, yeah. And again, if they're such friends, why not just have the girl up in first class with her? You know?
Yeah, I know. Why don't you pay for your friend?
You can't have your minions riding side by side with you, can you?
Really? That's bizarre.
You'd get confused.
To fumigate the plane, imagine how much it costs the airline to deal with that.
They were waiting for me. I'm bleeding. Why am I all like this everywhere?
God, those girls.
Oh, hey, what geez. A show it's going to be today when they open arguments in the Court of Appeals for Michael Fletcher.
Ah.
Yeah. He, of course, is deciding that he didn't get a fair shake at his trial. He's, of course, in prison for second-degree murder and serving a life term, and he wants to have another go of it.
Yeah, take two.
The arguments for whether he'll get an appeals will be today in Detroit.
Oh, I hope not.
Oh, you're not kidding. I hope they just shoot it down immediately. I don't like the way the first one turned out.
Shot your pregnant wife.
Yeah, how do you like that?
Nice guy.
Right there. Yeah.
One of the reasons why he thinks that is because jurors in the case told the ABC News magazine 2020 after the trial that they had tried to reenact the shooting of Fletcher's wife to determine how the gun may have fallen. That's his basis.
That Scott Peterson story was just chilling yesterday. You
Someone
know,
else?
You brought it to my attention first thing, and then I saw it again on MSNBC. They were talking about how he wanted to sell the house, sold her vehicle. I mean, what could scream more loudly than that? The vehicle that his 8 months pregnant wife was driving, he sells it?
Unless he donated her clothes to the Goodwill. Now that would really seal it. But.
Boy, that guy, he is quite a sociopath, too. Every time you see him talking, you can tell this just is an annoyance.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They had to be cussing at Barbara Streisand's mansion after hearing that the gigantic Clinton supporter, actor Richard Gere, actually admitted at a fundraiser George Bush is much better in the fight against AIDS than his great presidential love, Bill Clinton, at the fundraiser in Chicago.
Is that right?
Yeah, Gere, who was booed at the concert for New York in 2001 for his kind of liberal statement there.
Let's all make love.
Whammo.
Peace, baby.
That was ridiculous. He deserved it.
Yeah, to the families of the victims.
That was disgusting.
Nice reading the room, Gere.
Yeah. A wipe.
He didn't read the emergency room very well either.
What an ass. Yeah, right.
He did a 180
nice habit trail
yesterday, saying, "I'm sorry, Senator Clinton," to Hillary, who was supposed to be in the audience, "but your husband did nothing about AIDS for 8 years. She was already gone from the fundraiser by then. Phil Spector still out on bond, though police should read the most recent interview with Spector 2 weeks ago before the 40-year-old actress ended up on his foyer floor with a fatal gunshot, telling the reporter from the British paper, the Daily Mail, that he thought he was either schizophrenic or bipolar, and he was on medicine for it. He copped to having devils fighting inside his mind. He's an insomniac, never sleeps, says his mind plays tricks on him at night. And he couldn't stand himself, and further, was such a nut, he was petrified that his daughter would either get it or she would start dating guys like him, who he describes as guys who would be manic, depressive, psychotics, or cuckoo she might be attracted to because of the way she was raised.
Okay, I think it was time to lock him up right then and there.
The woman who is now ensconced in her final role in the morgue in Los Angeles was Lana Clarkson, who starred in some cult sci-fi soft porn flicks like Barbarian Queen, in which she would fight evildoers like a topless Xena warrior princess. And some other things. She was trying to stay in the business by eking by with trade show jobs, modeling, and snapping up commercials. Finally, she had to take a hostess job at the House of Blues, which her manager says was such a waste because she was a talent who had a comedic flair. Thanks in part to the Smoking Gun's little PR story about Sarah Kosar's bondage and foot fetish thing, Joe Millionaire had 21 million viewers on Monday for Fox TV.
That's a monster audience.
Yeah, that show
and
was just, whoa.
A thorn in the side to Everybody Loves Raymond. His fans didn't love him enough to stay with him when the soap opera of Joe Millionaire was on the other channel. And there's
Manner,
this little dirt out on the butler. Paul Hogan?
Yeah.
Bill Paley, though, the son of the founder of CBS TV, leaking that Hogan was once the caretaker at his palatial palace in the Bahamas and, quote-unquote, remodeled the wine cellar by drinking it all with these big parties he threw for his Aussie friends. Paley was ready to fire him, but Hogan quit first. Trudy Daniels for Frack Roll Radio News.
Hey, we just got this scoop from the news leader in, where is this? Is this New Jersey? I'm not sure where. Springfield news leader. No, this is from Missouri. This is from the home of Aaron Burge.
Right, right.
The, really? The Bachelor. He and Helene have split up. It's over. It's official.
Really?
Yes, the bloom's off the rose.
Too funny.
She was talked to Extra, and so she wouldn't talk about it until Extra aired. But he wanted to go public because he wanted to be relieved of the status of having the relationship out there in people's minds. He says, I don't want to say anything bad about her. Of course, he acts as if he can't wait for people to know it's over.
Yeah.
Hi, nice to meet you.
I'm Olive. Helene, that's a unique name for an outstanding and beautiful woman.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, God.
The problem was, after the show finished taping, until the show was over, they couldn't have any contact or had minimal contact.
Right,
he said, that doomed the relationship.
Oh, yeah, right, all that time. Jeez, if that's all it takes.
Haven't asked for the ring back. He says, I have no plans of getting the ring back because that was an unconditional gift to her. The ring is yours as long as you keep it yourself.
Really?
As long as you keep it yourself.
Well, she'll pawn it in
seconds.
Now,
that's a condition. He's saying if you sell it, it's mine.
Well, how's he going to know if she sells or pawns it? How would he know?
I haven't seen chemistry like that since Rosie O'Donnell poked Tom Cruise with her strap on.
She's indicated,
that's hilarious, man. This is something else.
She's indicated that holding the ring in her possession is painful for her, and she would like to get rid of it. So he knows she wants to get rid of it.
Yeah.
And he's saying it's hers as long as it's in her possession. But I don't want anyone else to have it. So if she wants to dispose of it in any manner, I would prefer to have it back in my possession because it represents a great time in my life.
A great time
of
his
crap.
Life.
You want to pawn it.
Exactly.
You want
Come
your
on.
Money back.
It's a great time of your life.
That's really funny because remember he insisted on spending his own money for the ring?
Oh, yeah. Oh, most definitely. Because
and now he insists that no one else get his own money back.
Yeah, and that thing wasn't cheap either. I mean, that was a hell of a ring.
Make a good footrest.
Hey, I'm good for something, right?
That's pretty good for other stuff, too. I'm glad you liked it.
Memory problem.
Oh, this is all the video of her talking while they're kissing.
That's right.
I think that's hilarious.
Maybe we should go back and get in the hot tub.
You want to get in the hot tub?
There's a hot tub on the boat, too.
I think there's a hot tub up there, so we can get into our swimsuits.
We'll get in the hot tub later. That'll be fine.
The suite has a hot tub.
We just need to sneak upstairs and put our seats on top of the hot tub.
It'd be nice to get in the hot tub.
Dessert.
We'll go back and get in the hot tub with the bachelor pad, guys.
Probably not.
You know, it's
Everybody
funny.
Loves the hot tub.
Tonight on The Bachelorette, you're going to see, Mike and I have both seen this already.
This is
going to
be great, yeah.
You're going to see Trista read the letter where they say, you both have beautiful hotel suites, but if you'd like to stay together in the fantasy suite for the night, then you're welcome to, and here's the key.
Yep.
And she reads the letter to all three of these guys.
She sure does.
Yeah.
She's the one that offers up the suite. How trampy can you get?
I won't tell you how many she stayed with, more than one.
Oh, yeah.
Now, last week
I
when
can
we
tell you who's going to bomb on the rose, too.
Yeah, I
agree with your assessment on that. I mean, it's obvious. I mean, when you see it tonight, it'll be very obvious to you who is going to go bye-bye when rose time comes.
Now, let's see. She had said last week when we talked to her that she never said she was in love with two people or could be in love with two people.
Yeah.
She says it so many times tonight,
constantly.
It's not even funny.
She says it constantly, that she has absolutely fallen in love with two people.
At the same time.
At the same time.
She didn't know how it could happen, but now she knows.
But now she knows, which is
absolutely
ridiculous.
She denied it on our show.
Yeah. And it's
you
just
what,
so
remember,
ridiculous. She's infatuated, that's all.
You talked to her about the tabloid stuff that was being said about her?
Yeah.
And she didn't hear or she didn't care to respond about the pregnancy thing.
Oh,
yes.
Yeah.
Right? She's just like, that's not true about me being with Charlie or something like that. She didn't respond to any of the pregnancy allegations.
I don't believe that she wasn't aware of that tabloid story.
Oh, she
either.
Knew about
She's
that.
She's got it framed somewhere.
Oh, she knows about
she
that.
She loves herself.
And E.T. came at her about the pregnancy issue. E.T. come at her about that. The other thing, by the way, that Trista says tonight, she says, I need someone to make me feel special and warm and a couple of other things every day of my life. And it was just like, the minute I heard that, I was like, whoa, stop, rewind. It's just this girl is so needy.
You know what I mean? She wants to be the focus of everything all the time.
You know what, though? Her head is just, it's just a big collection of air, isn't it, really?
Yeah,
I mean,
no,
watching
it is.
This show, it's like,
no, it
does
is.
She ever say anything substantive?
No.
And this guy, Russ.
Absolutely not.
Russ, who I'm not a fan of, but no. Without giving too much away.
Yeah.
He's really trying to pin her down on how she feels, because she's asking these guys, you know, so what's it going to be? Well, are you nuts guys, about me or what?
Yeah, all these guys are trying to figure out where they stand.
And she doesn't want to say anything, and I realize I don't think she has anything to say.
I don't think so. I really don't. I think that's the funny thing about it, is that everybody's waiting for her to say something of substance,
God,
and there isn't
man.
Anything there.
I know.
I'm so shocked.
I thought she was one of the deepest people on the planet.
Yeah. In the end, she just loves the camera, loves herself. She's an egomaniac, and she needs somebody to make her feel special every single second. And the minute she's not the center of attention, comes unglued.
Her voice is bothering me more every week, I know.
Her voice has been irritating forever. It just drills right through your eardrum.
Oh, this is so beautiful.
Yeah. And then the minute she sees her dates, it's always like,
oh. Charlie.
She's so put on every time Ryan reads his stupid second grade level poetry.
It's you always, were saying that you don't like guys that are, you know, somewhat aggressive or anything like that.
Totally.
But then yet you kiss me out of the blue.
That was not out of the blue. You were all over me. You were pulling me aside into the bathroom
happened. I was, but I wasn't going to kiss you. No, I just mean that, like, tonight.
She loved it at the time.
You know, I just couldn't really be myself and do things like generally I would do. Like, I don't think it's totally romantic sitting on one side of a table.
Well, then why didn't you say something?
No. Just because I was in the seat and pulled you closer to me.
What's with these guys? They're the biggest sap.
They are.
You know, while we're sitting here talking about it, you're saying things like, you know, you don't like a guy to be doing stuff like that.
I've printed up the lyrics to the four songs I've written about you.
Oh, just
I've got a picture of the sunset we sat at.
Wasn't that dumb?
I've got another poem for you.
Yeah.
And I've painted this for you.
Yeah, that paint by numbers tiger. How stupid was that?
It's just a little something I came up with yesterday called Something About Her. Here I am.
More poetry tonight, by the way.
Poetry
here
sucks.
I am, looking for a place to land. My heart in the palm of her hand, a boy dying to be her man. Between tomorrow and yesterday, what I really want to say
all he does is try to
I'm falling for something about her. She is to me the rainbow through the rain. She is to me the laughter through the pain.
I knew it was going to be
she's living
pain.
In my dreams. She's a vision, and it seems that I'm falling for something about her.
You know, with his poetry,
I could see wanting to doink her, but I mean, beyond that, I can't. I would be out of there so fast. I did that.
I know it.
Woo.
And the thing of it is, with all of his poetry, it's just all these really simplified rhyming patterns. His second verse, you can always predict what the word is that he's going to rhyme.
Are you analyzing someone's poetry for crying out loud?
Yeah,
what's the matter with you?
Because it's so ridiculous. Tonight, his poetry is extra special.
Do you find it odd to hide the fact that you're gay?
His poetry is so stupid. Stupid tonight. Oh my God. And the minute he says that last word of the first verse, you know it's like he's going to rhyme on that word. And it's always the obvious word.
Boy, we're getting a lot of email about firefighters wearing their clothes everywhere. People are noticing this phenomenon. Was there one that just came in?
It all started because we were talking about Ryan, who works for the Vail Fire Department. And every one of these installments of Bachelorette, he's wearing that T-shirt.
It's a chick magnet.
I know it is.
Yes.
I know it is. I don't blame them.
Yeah.
Because they don't have the Porsche, so why not? Right. Wear the shirt.
It's a very, you can always tell one, too, even from a distance.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
What
they're very distinct.
That little design looks like.
Very distinct, yeah.
Friend of mine wears firefighter hat and T-shirt every day. Cheeseball, parentheses. And he used to make fun of people for it. Hypocrite. He gives us his phone number. He listens to you guys every day. He's off right now. He tripped over a hose and hurt his ankle. forgot about sports here. Quickly brought to you by American Equity Mortgage. You can combine all your bills into one new low monthly payment, even with less than perfect credit. Call 888-71-LOAN-1. And Mariucci, 4 o'clock this afternoon. $25 million over 5 years. Wow. Did the Fords dig deep for this one?
Boy, oh boy.
Number one football prospect in the Midwest has chosen University of Michigan. Linebacker from Saginaw, Lamar Woodley. Wings blew a 5-2 lead, and up at a 5-all tie. Disappointing. Cujo gives up 5 goals and 28 shots. Robitaille got a goal, though. That's a good sign. Shanny, too. He's been slumping a bit. Proby's in rehab. Pistons host the Clippers tonight. No Ben Wallace. Still mourning his mother. LeBron James going to court to get back on the court, as if he cares. 6th-ranked Kentucky defeated the number one team in the country, Florida, last night, 70-55.
And delay in the Jason Williams manslaughter trial scheduled to begin February 18th. You know, that's another one of these celebrity trials. It's so frustrating. You just want to...
I know it.
See these guys get what they deserve. You know they're going to get a better
Never.
Sentence anyway.
Oh,
but
of course. And to watch it unfold right in front of you is so maddening.
Mm-hmm.
It just drives you nuts. It's just so unfair.
Face guards and softer balls can reduce injuries in Little League Baseball, according to new research. American Medical Association links face guards with a 35% reduced risk of facial injuries, safety balls with a 23% reduced risk.
Oh, jeez, oh, here we go. Why don't you just
they're talking about using tennis balls in Little League.
Oh, come on.
What a bunch of little powder puffs.
Oh, come on.
You know, this isn't fair. The adults, I think adults owe it to children to create just some tiny, tiny element of risk. Tiny.
Honest to God.
I don't mean risk your kids' health and well-being, but
people have been playing these sports for years and years and years and years and years and years.
What are we going to do next? Put these kids in traction until they're 18?
Oh, they're all
I mean, that's what's next.
I know. And they're all in glass bubbles. I mean, everybody's, it's natural selection, you know?
Something else I'm getting tired of is all this stupid bullshit we have to listen to all the time about children. It's all you hear in this country. Children. Help the children. What about the children? Save the children. You know what I say? F*** the children. They're getting entirely too much attention. And I know what you're thinking. You say, Jesus, he's not going to attack children, is he? Yes, he is.
He's on.
I also know all you single dads and soccer moms who think you're such fucking heroes aren't going to like this. Your children are overrated and overvalued. You've turned them into little cult objects. You have a child fetish, and it's not healthy. Don't give me that weak Well, I love my children. F*** you. Everybody loves their children. Doesn't make you special. John Wayne Gacy loved his children. Kept them all right out in the yard near the garage. That's not what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about is this constant mindless yammering in the media, this neurotic fixation that somehow everything has to be revolved around children. It's completely out of balance. Listen, there are a couple of things about kids you have to remember. First of all, they're not all cute, okay? In fact, if you look at them close, some of them are rather unpleasant looking. And a lot of them don't smell too good either. The little ones in particular seem to have a kind of urine and sour milk combination. Stay with me on this. The sooner you face it, the better off you're going to be. Second premise, not all children are smart and clever. Got that? Kids are like any other group of people. A few winners, a whole lot of losers. There are a lot of loser kids out there who simply aren't going anywhere. And you can't save them all. You can't save them all. You got to let them go. You got to cut them loose. You got to stop overprotecting them because you're making them too soft. Today's kids are way too soft. For one thing, there's too much emphasis on safety. Child-proof medicine bottles
Bingo.
And fireproof pajamas, child restraints and car seats and helmets, bicycle, skateboard, baseball helmets. Kids have to wear helmets now for everything but jerking off. Grown-ups have taken all the fun out of being a kid just to save a few thousand lives. It's pathetic. It's pathetic. What's happening is, you know what it is? These baby boomers, these soft, fruity baby boomers, are raising an entire generation of soft, fruity kids who aren't even allowed to have hazardous toys, for Christ's sake. Hazardous toys. Whatever happened to natural selection? Survival of the fittest. The kid who swallows too many marbles doesn't grow up to have kids of his own. Simple. Nature knows best. We're saving entirely too many lives in this country of all ages. Nature should be allowed to do its job of killing off the weak and sickly and ignorant people without interference from airbags and batting helmets. Just think of it as passive eugenics, okay? Now, here's another example of overprotection. Did you ever notice on the TV news, every time some guy with an AK-47 strolls onto a schoolyard and kills three or four kids and a couple of teachers, the next day, the school is overrun with counselors and psychiatrists and grief counselors and trauma therapists trying to help the children cope. When I was in school, someone came to our school and killed three or four of us. We went right on with our arithmetic. 35 classmates minus 4 equals 39. We were tough. One more item about children, and that is this superstitious nonsense that blames tobacco companies for kids who smoke. Listen, kids don't smoke because a camel in sunglasses tells them to. They smoke for the same reasons adults do, because it relieves anxiety and depression. And you'd be anxious and depressed, too, if you had to put up with these pathetic, insecure, striving, anal, yuppie parents who enroll you in college before you're old enough to know which side of the playpen smells the worst. And then they fill you full of Ritalin and drag you all over town in search of meaningless structure. Little League, Cub Scouts, swimming, soccer, karate, piano, bagpipes, watercolors, witchcraft, glass blowing, and dildo practice. They even have play dates, for Christ's sakes. Playing is now done by appointment. Whatever happened to you show me your wee-wee and I'll show you mine. Hey, no wonder kids smoke. It helps. Not as much as weed, but hey. It can't have everything. You know it's true. Parents are burning these kids out on structure. I think every day all children should have 3 hours of daydreaming. Just daydreaming. And you could use a little of it yourself, by the way. Just sit at the window, stare at the clouds. It's good for you.
What are you, a wise ass?
Your children, leave them the f*** alone.
Oh, we were looking for it last hour, and Mark and Mike dug it up.
You don't know what you're talking about, do you?
Man, that was beautiful.
It's funny. I was listening to that. I was thinking, we are getting progressively softer with each generation, because it's not just kids now. We were softer than our parents.
I used to walk out of school.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, my dad was in World War II.
Right.
He was in Okinawa. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we've never faced anything like God forbid. I mean, I wouldn't want to. And if I was a kid, too, if I was a kid now, I'd want to play video games all day. I wouldn't mind the soft. As George said, and we've talked about this before, can't we just assume people love kids?
Oh,
people have
God,
to run around
yes.
saying how much they love their kids.
Oh, I know it.
And I know if your kid got a scholarship to Harvard, sure, you're going to be blowing up with pride. And you're going to tell everybody you know. But come on a day-in, day-out basis, there's not that much to say about kids.
No, there really isn't. And nobody cares, you know? Nobody cares. They just tolerate it.
Yeah, isn't that why people with parents find people with parents? They stop hanging around with their single, childless kids because
no question.
They'll tolerate each other's kid BS.
Each other's babble.
Do either of them want to hear the other one?
Hell no.
I doubt it.
No, absolutely not. They feign the whole thing. It's totally fake. No question about it.
It's 9:33. Arsenio apparently not very locatable this morning. He must have gone out with Phil Spector last night. Arsenio will be with us tomorrow to talk about Star Search tomorrow night.
Take the day off, Hall.
But back to TV. You know, it's funny, you guys both watched the same show yesterday, and Mark brought the tape in. This hilarious Maury Povich, where I guess when they can't have paternity tests, they go to, what is this, sex vigilantes?
Yeah. Basically, well, you got this group. Well, boy,
sex
where to start
on tape
this?
Ruined my life is the thing.
Okay. Yeah.
But this guy,
that's the best overall way to look at it.
Mark's queued up this guy who, he had a lot of prostitution in his neighborhood, so he literally started running around with a video camera?
Precisely, and he films it and then turns the film into the cops and gets them busted.
Now, why he turns into the cops and the cop, was he filmed the license plate?
Yeah, films the license plate, the guy's face and the girl's face.
Why don't the cops just come out there?
He just claims they won't do it if you call them.
Really?
Yeah, which, I mean, who knows?
Well, you know, that's
I think he's getting off on filming these people.
I think there's no question.
One, because most of them are nude, and two, because he's just getting off on filming them.
Well, sure.
I do think what happens is once he starts doing it, he gets carried away, and he's like Mr. Vigilante sex guy.
Yeah, when
he likes seeing guys' dicks.
When he's setting up lighting, and he's got a sound guy, I mean, come on, that's a little over the edge.
And he's up for Oscars, right, you know, for sound editing
and if he
whatnot.
Gets caught, even if he's hard, okay, good. You can say, hey, I'm filming this.
Come on now.
It's a professional thing.
Okay.
You know?
I do feel bad for these people that have these crack houses and these hookers in their neighborhood. I mean, what a miserable scenario that is to have that going on. And, I give him credit for that. He does seem to be a little carried away. But roll the tape. It's pretty funny. I wish we could show the video, but the audio is
have a lewd act,
amusing,
and,
too.
As you'll see, when you see the tape, this isn't somebody you want around your children.
Okay. Watch this, everybody.
Just walks up to the cars. There's a guy completely naked on top of this chick in the passenger seat.
In the
in broad daylight.
He just swung open the driver's door.
What are you doing?
I'm making love, my girl.
I'm making love?
Yeah.
In my pants.
What are you doing? Circle around his dick.
In my pants.
What are you doing? He took his pants.
Yeah.
In my pants.
What are you doing with the hooker?
I'm not doing no hooker.
Nice English.
She's my girlfriend.
No, she's not. You know how many times I followed her?
Huh?
You know how many times I followed her?
She's walking away from the car topless.
Yeah. Get my pants. You got what you wanted, didn't you?
No, you'll go to jail.
Huh?
You'll go to jail.
You got my keys.
No, I don't.
Stain on his underwear. Did you see that?
Yeah. I had him in your pants.
Steal my car.
Tried to steal my car. What a dick.
The guy laughing at him.
You perfected a new trick, taking the keys.
That's right. He couldn't get away that time. It's
Well, he should have filmed the guy's dick long enough,
yeah.
Didn't he?
Oh, yeah.
He zoomed in on it.
Not only that, he captured his dick when it was hard, when it was half hard, and when it was limp. He got Maury, all stages of his dick.
Shouldn't Maury have a Woody checker on the set there to see if the guy's hard?
Yeah. It's possible. Guy. It's really funny how this guy runs up to the car, like, from behind.
Oh, yeah.
He's in such a hurry, and then he flings the door open.
Yeah. I mean, think people are so engrossed in what they're doing, they don't. Well, they have no idea he's there.
I mean, how shocked could they be when you show up?
First thing you got to remember, all these guys claim that they're a first-timer.
Right.
They've never done this before. It's an accident. She attacked him. All of this sort of thing. And I never know if it's the truth or not, but one thing I can be sure of, if I catch you, I don't know if it was your first time or not, but it'll definitely be your last time.
Okay, take a look at this.
Big ass. It's funny how they put the obscuring thing at the bottom of the guy's butt crack and he
right.
has balls.
Yeah, exactly.
Make you go famous. She knows what's going to happen. Ask what's going to happen. I bet your mama's happy, wouldn't she? She's sorry. Not you. You. What'd your mama say?
Yeah,
why are you doing this then?
Man, that's my first time doing it, man.
Look at that big fat off ass. Of her. What are you doing back here on this property? Huh?
What a slob.
And they had to put a big circle around his dick.
What's he got to ask him about his mother for? What's his mom have to do with it?
This, Brian?
Well, I got to tell you, Maury.
I think he was hard.
The day that the hookers
I'm beginning to wonder about this guy.
We were tired of seeing the sex in our church parking lots, in our grocery store parking lots, everyone in the block, but they're like roaches. And if you ignore them, it only gets worse. If you call the police and say what you saw, nothing happens. But if you catch it on tape, they get prosecuted. And
I'd spend some of that taping time looking for a new job because that is a neighborhood skank.
In the heat of the moment here, right?
This guy was stupid enough. Not only is he on the job, he's in a marked vehicle. He's a married man. He has a family at home. Parks behind a grocery store that's got few hundred people right out in front of it and is willing to risk all of that for $10 and a girl walking up and down the street.
Take a look.
He just runs up to the car.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, boy.
She's
on top of him.
Sitting on him, facing him.
Yeah, I see that, you're picking up prostitutes.
No, I'm not a prostitute.
We've been watching you all day over there on Shields.
I'm not a prostitute.
You're not? What do you think you're doing on top of him in here?
Well, I can him. He's my friend.
You can him. He's your friend? He's going to jail. I'd stop the car.
I'd stop the car.
Now he's pretending to be a cop.
I know, he's funny. This
he has
guy
no
really
authority. I'm surprised these guys don't get out and knock him from here in Mississippi.
Yeah. Some
punch
of them,
his
some
lights
of them,
out, take his camera.
Some of them do get pissed. They also have the investigative guys from, what's the TV show?
Cheaters.
Cheaters, yeah. Go up and, oh my God, do they bust people.
Oh, yeah,
you know,
that's
what's funny
huge.
Is the guy that they bust who's sleeping with a girl's friend, he goes, I don't think we're that serious.
I know, yeah, exactly.
So we've been dating for 6 months. Weren't they almost engaged? Or something?
Yeah, close to it.
Yeah.
6 months, yeah.
We'll come back. It's 9:40 at WRIF.
Hi, this is Jerry Mathers, the Beaver, and you're listening to the Eddie Haskells of Detroit, Drew and Mike on 101 WRIF.
Nice Beaver.
Thank you.
Drew and Mike on the Riff. Look for entry forms and details. Drew and Mike on 101 WRIF Detroit.
Okay. People were disappointed with the letters to the editor in this week. Boy, they had a bunch of really pissy people.
Oh, excellent. Let me hear.
Paula Michaels Olive of Elizabethtown, Kentucky.
Well, I admire Catherine Zeta-Jones' work. I must comment on her remarks about having a second child. As an only child and the mother of an only child, I've grown weary of the stereotype. We're no longer lonely, spoiled, or unhappy, no more than people with other siblings. I'm surprised Ms. Zeta-Jones bought into the myth. If she wants to have a second child, she should have one, period. Who cares why?
Who cares
well,
why?
Sounds like things in the only child world are maybe a little sensitive. Nothing else? They had a story about kids and too much homework, which I have to say I haven't really noticed at Tessa's house.
Well, that could be a problem.
They seem to have enough. Not too much.
Well, I've heard a lot of kids complain that they're just inundated with homework, just way too much.
Yeah, no, I've heard this before.
Depends on the school, I don't know.
I don't think you should have too much.
God, I know in Catholic school, oh, man, with those nuns growing up, oh, God, do they pound us with homework.
Well, it's back to these overachieving, perfect kids that everybody's trying to create.
Exactly.
Yeah. Come on, let kids have a little fun.
I know. Well, they put them in school when they're three, you know.
By the time my husband and I get off work, pick up the kids, eat dinner, start homework, the evening is over. We have a first and fourth grader that get homework every night. There are more important things in life than homework, but the teachers and school districts have their own agenda, which doesn't include family time.
Well, hey, Madeline, if you want to have a bunch of slackers, go ahead. You don't have to go to school.
Well, the problem is probably she's doing most of the homework for them. The kids probably come home, they're confused. How are you going to do? They're starting to cry. Here, let me help you.
And that's your fault if you do your work for them. That's your problem.
So parents and their crybaby kids think teachers give them too much homework. Well, boo-hoo. I'm a high school teacher. I deny there's too much. Homework is necessary to reinforce skills and make up for time lost by teachers who are busy disciplining students. Students are too busy working, hanging out, or glued to TV and video games to take responsibility for their own education. It's far easier to blame teachers. Later.
So that teacher is going to make sure they're not on a video machine, huh?
So, Jennifer Lopez did swap Ben Affleck's generous tip of $5,000 for $300.
This is with a dealer in Vegas.
Yeah.
He put $5,000 across the table, and she reached and poof, grabbed it and put $3,100s.
Really?
Bitch. Yeah, she didn't want Ben tipping $5,000, so it was too much.
Oh, man.
I'd like to ask her why his excessive spending is all right if it's directed at her, but not when it's given to a poor working stiff who needs it more than she does. Valerie over in Pottstown, Pennsylvania.
That's a beauty. That's a great one.
And here's another slacker raiser.
As a mom having raised two older children and starting off with two young adopted kids, I couldn't agree more that the amount of homework given is ridiculous. And the overload is not beneficial to any student. If anyone knows of a school in my area that agrees with my sentiments, please let me know. I'll be the first in line to register my two girls. Later.
It's my party and I'll eat if I want to. Hi, this is Richard Simmons. Do you want to start your morning off with a happy, happy, happy smile? Then listen to Drew, Mike, and the beautiful Trudi on WRIF 101.1.
Convention.
101 WRIF Detroit.
We were on the letters to the editor, and there were a couple others I wanted to mention. Rolling Stone got a lot of letters after putting Justin Timberlake on the cover. You know, isn't that a sad day when a music magazine, one that's pretty well respected, has to... Well, it's okay for them to update their format. I understand Rolling Stone was maybe a little stale the way it used to be, and they needed to get a little more youthful or whatever it is they're doing. But do we have to see Twinkie pop stars with their shirts off on the cover?
They're just created by, they're just products created by the music industry thrown together. And
well, he might be a little more than that, but it's
Barely.
It's a rock and roll magazine. It seems to me at least the person on the cover should be within the rock and roll life group or lifestyle.
Well, respected, musicians that have a storied past and are really legitimate.
As for the naked
people
women,
that are very talented, you know, it seems to me to be on the cover of Rolling Stone was always the big thing. Are you kidding?
Sure.
If you made it to the cover of Rolling Stone, I mean, you were something.
Well, and you'd see David Letterman on the cover once in a while, but he's sort of in.
Oh yeah, well, fits, that or Seinfeld,
you know,
or something.
You sort of know who fits and who doesn't. And Justin Timberlake, I'm sorry, no, he does not belong in with his shirt off.
Too much of a doink with shirts off.
Topless women, that's different.
Yeah. No, I mean, it's ridiculous. I'm so sick of all those little punks running around thinking they're hot crap. You know, they're all like really all little American idols, really.
there's a lot of letters about that, too.
About American Idol?
No, about...
Or just about all these little joints?
Yeah, but it was just about him being on the cover.
God, it's also plastic, isn't it? Just seeing all those little idiots running around and Britney Spears and... Oh, God.
Listen to this. This is kind of funny. This issue of Rolling Stone blew my mind. This is from a chick. This issue of Rolling Stone blew my mind. I've been looking forward to it ever since I saw a preview on MTV's TRL. Haven't been a fan of NSYNC since the beginning. It was great to hear Justin saying F and S.
Oh.
The swear words.
Oh, how stupid.
That he's grown up in more ways than one is great. And he isn't afraid to admit that he went down in Britney. That's even better. I hope that this Justin is here to stay shirtless.
Oh,
if that is the average Rolling Stone reader, then I want out.
That is terrible. Terrible letter. Ugh.
Here's another chick.
Jeez.
Maybe the reason Justin's girlfriends all cheat on him is because he's a mama's boy. Grow up, Justin. Be a man. Then maybe all your girlfriends wouldn't be inclined to go somewhere else for satisfaction. He does. All his girlfriends dump him in that article. That was one of the things it said. I'm ashamed to admit I read it. Finally, after having endured countless covers of naked, near-naked chicks, you put a male on the cover. Unfortunately, it's someone who is not a boy and not yet a man. Spare us. I'd rather see a near-naked Keith Richards again. At least he personifies what music is all about. Sharon Cope, hey.
Hmm.
Right on, sister.
Yeah, that's it. Putting a seasoned musician up there. Somebody that deserves to be on the cover.
And here's somebody who's pissed off because Joe Strummer from The Clash died, and who's on the cover? Justin Timberlake. It's usually I laugh at people who write stuff like that, but this is one of those where I'm going, yes! Joe Strummer was one cool cat. And then Rob Skane of Albany writes, when Patti Smith dies, can we expect to see Pink's fat ass on the cover of Rolling Stone?
Pink's fat ass. Fat ass.
People are now starting to cut out and send in letters to the editor because so many of them are so funny. And
well, they're hilarious.
Well, there's always a lot of heart in them. People are usually peeved.
Well, yeah, to write a letter, I mean, mm-hmm. You know, everybody's in that push-button world, and email is so quick and so disposable, and you just write it, and boom, it's gone. But when you sit down and write a letter, then you're really pissed. You really have something to say.
This one's written to Hustler. We were reading that that ridiculous story yesterday on family members who do porn together.
Yeah.
This is from their letters to the editor.
One of those all highlighted, the whole article.
I didn't really read these. I just read February 2003 Hustler. The new format kicks major ass. You got to wonder if you notice a format change in Hustler.
I think you're too into porn. Yeah, you're too into Hustler. That magazine is such a rag. I haven't seen it for years, but that's some kind of magazine.
Please stop showing gay crap in your magazine. I love the raw quality of Hustler, but sometimes it's just too much. Like the queer picture of that naked artist in your October issue. That's some guy in fashion. A fashion section, it's a dude.
Okay.
I buy a magazine for one simple reason, and then he uses the P word,
yeah,
P-U-S,
blank. Oh, yeah.
It's bad enough to see those homo phone ads and transvestite crap, but at least they're only ads. Why the hell would fags be buying this magazine anyway? Don't they have their own porn? Anyway, just keep it up. And then he uses the C word for female anatomy.
Yeah.
Not the C word for male anatomy. And please give us more furry muffs. Some of us prefer bushy. Not the shiny you become fond of. To sum up, I can't read what he summed up.
Like he has to sum anything up. He said everything. We get the point. And we understand your point of view.
You give me a bush, dude. I'm walking. I don't care how old a guy I am. I don't care how hard my dick is. I'm walking out of that room.
Listen to this email. Did you hear this, Mike?
Yes, I did.
Did you really?
Yes.
Hey there, it sounds like someone is yelling, Drew and Mike, in the spot for that 70s show that you've been playing today. It's right after the announcer stops talking and the actors begin. It's probably a subliminal thing.
It starts with the Scott Lewis, I think it's Scott Lewis, Problem Solvers.
Huh.
And then it goes into their Wednesday lineup for that 70s show. Listen.
Would they be smart enough to put whatever morning show's name that they're playing the spot in the produced spot?
It's someone from that 70s show. It's one of the actors from that 70s show. It Sounds like he yells, Drew and Mike.
I can't picture
that,
it.
That couldn't be. That has to be done locally.
It has to just be one of those. Yeah.
The night of Fox 2 Problem Solver Investigation.
Well, Gander Mountain. We've had so many emails about that.
Oh, you're not kidding. And
it cracks me up. I listen to the spot more because...
Oh, yeah.
And those who know what I'm talking about.
Oh, yeah. And every time I hear it, it's like, oh, that's exactly what they're saying. There's no question.
The name you trust in home improvement.
They're guaranteed forever.
But who are you really getting?
The secret is in the fine print.
That's terrible.
This real shoddy work.
Bench and Stinger blows the lid off this home impairment. Tonight at 10, Fox 2 News is working for you.
Fox Wednesday on an all-new That 70 Show.
Girl,
it's the battle of the belt.
Plain as day.
Jessica Simpson.
Plain as day.
Over Kelso.
I didn't have to read anything into that.
I wonder what the person was saying.
I don't know.
Oh, my God. That's pretty wild. Plain as day.
Hmm.
That's really weird.
Isn't that funny?
That's bizarre.
I don't think that's what they're really saying, though, do you?
It can't be.
No, it can't be.
But yet, it's
terrible. This real shy work.
Bench and Stinger blows the lid off.
I like this guy's
environment.
Voice.
Tonight at 10, Fox 2 News is working for you.
Fox Wednesday on an all-new That 70 Show.
Girl,
it's the Battle of the Bays.
My God.
Is this wild?
I can't hear anything but Drew and Mike.
What's he saying?
Maybe they're just trying to get you guys to play their spot more. I don't know.
Well, it worked if it is the case.
Yeah,
that's funny. Well, yeah, and they probably sent the email, too.
That's a nice little subliminal running in there.
Yeah, it reminds me, Channel 2, I hope that guy called who said he got kicked out of Greektown Casino last night. This guy called and said he won $6,000 playing blackjack, was just having a good old time sitting there winning away, had a nice little table rhythm going, and they came up and said, I'm sorry, you're a little out of hand. Or, what did they say? Why did they say they were kicking him out? Oh, he's causing a disturbance, which is, I've heard that exact term used from other people who've been kicked out. And then someone else, did you talk to the second guy who said he was kicked out, Mike?
Yeah.
Was he kicked out last night?
I think they were rowdy too. Oh, no, he was saying that when they win so much money, they had their chips in their pocket, and the chips were making too much noise.
What?
Oh, come on.
I don't know.
That is preposterous.
Wow.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's just absurd.
We've seen the story. They do kick people out for winning too much. It's true.
Isn't that amazing?
I can't imagine.
Look how much money the casinos make. I mean, look at the money.
Well, that makes me say, when I hear stuff like that, I say, oh, the deck's stacked. If you win, they kick you out. If you lose, it's fine.
God.
You know, until they start kicking people out for losing, then I'm not going to think a whole lot of this policy.
It's a good thing to have people win.
Well, sure. I mean, the guy's going to go around, he's going to tell 500 people, you won't believe what a great night I had, and they're all going to go, and they're all going to lose their ass.
And they're going to go to the very same casino, no question. Right. Yeah, and they will. They will lose. Yeah. You're right.
Well, and they did that guy a favor, too. He'd never won that much money. If they were smart, they would let him play, because he would have given some of the money back. He never won that much money before. He wasn't some seasoned. I mean, nobody can know that they're going to just continue winning thousands of dollars, not in blackjack.
No, $6,000 in 2 hours.
I'd never pull someone who was killing the house on blackjack.
No,
I'd say, boy, I hope they stay there forever, because they'll give it all back and then some. Hey, Jennifer.
Hi.
How you doing?
Good. How are you guys doing?
Good.
Good.
What's going on?
I was calling about that 70 show spot.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He says girl fight.
She says girl fight?
Yeah.
Sorry,
really?
Bubble
guy.
Yeah.
No, I didn't really think they said our names.
Oh, no, I
mean,
didn't
if
either.
It did, it would have to be someone local just playing a joke.
Right. I really didn't think that they were saying our names, but
yeah,
it's
because
all I can hear.
He asked them to fight, and then when they, then he asked them to kiss and make up.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah, okay. I saw the TV spot. Yeah. I should have known that. I was so absorbed in my own ego, I didn't even remember I'd seen the commercial.
The damn thing of it is, when you hear it, it's just so blatant, though. It just seems so obvious.
Okay.
Thanks. Wait, Jennifer.
Right,
Jennifer, one more thing.
She sounds hot.
You really do.
Thanks, guys.
You're welcome.
All right. You can go.
Are you cued to it?
I think pretty close.
Okay.
Fox 2 News is working for you.
Fox Wednesday on an all-new That 70 Show.
Girl fight!
Now it's girl fight. It's plain as day.
Isn't that funny how you can... Boy,
yeah.
It's just like that Rolling Stones song where it was like Taste of Tate.
Oh, you remember that?
Yeah, I Go Wild.
Yeah, I Go Wild. Mm-hmm. And then we had Tate the Fartiste.
Yeah, that was a little...
And
well,
that was plain as day.
It was about as close.
Oh, it was real clear.
Your Zeppelin
Tate. Taste of Tate.
Well, oh, yeah, Zeppelin.
My Led Zeppelin. I got my dick in the goddamn nose.
Yeah, that sounds like a plant lyric. Gargoyles and dicks in people's noses. And hedgerows. Already?
We used to drive around. Every time we were cruising around with guys, that thing came on the radio. Naturally, we were always just obliterated. I got my dick in the gun. That's all we could hear.
Who saw the O'Reilly Factor last night and can maybe email? I want to know why... okay, this guy, Jeremy Glick, or was it... I forgot the guy's first name. I remember the Glick guy that died in the plane that hit the... No, it was Pennsylvania. I think he was on the Pennsylvania plane, the Glick guy. He was with Todd Beamer. His father was on O'Reilly last night blaming the U.S. government for that 9/11. And I'm not sure why. I'm just curious because someone kind of gives a very oblique, ambiguous description of what happened. And I'm wondering, why was Glick's dad on there saying that? Sounds annoying. I certainly feel bad about him losing his son, but I'm just wondering why he was saying that. And then Chris says, see, for some reason I thought one of you guys is a fan of Brian Ferry Roxy Music. I like Roxy Music. You like Roxy Music, don't you, Trudy?
Yeah, I did. Not as much as Doug likes Roxy Music, though. He adores them.
They definitely had their day.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen Brian Ferry in concert several times. He always wears leather pants, true. Last time I was watching VH1 Classics Channel, and they show the video to More Than This, great tune from Avalon. And Brian Ferry was wearing cop pants. What?
Really? He's stealing your gig.
I can't believe that.
Hey, that's an exclusive situation you have going there. Can't have that.
And then Chris says, the women love that man. That's true. She's definitely got the chick thing going. Wow, that's
the
bizarre.
Cop pants.
Well, he needs to be
now.
Pants. He needs to be pants twice.
That's a problem.
Trudy brought to us by, how about the Dish Planet. Dish Planet can give you a better picture and save you money for only $19.98. Lower your payment to $17.98, I'm sorry, a month. Only at Dish Planet, 877-634-DISH. That's Dish 1798.
A wing found in a pond near Nacogdoches, Texas. They think it's one of the shuttle shards. It could be very important in the investigation of what happened there. Shuttle disintegration, possibly wondering if it may actually answer all of those questions by showing the damage done by that insulation piece. And then there was the whole thing about how scientists told them so 9 years ago.
Yeah, here we go.
Several scientists piping up that they realized something very much like what looks like happened to the Columbia would happen, and they predicted it. And studies from Carnegie Mellon and Stanford universities and issued a report to NASA specifically describing that if insulation, which seemed to serve the purpose of falling off and damaging heat tiles only, if it hit in certain areas, the shuttle could be lost.
Yeah, but they're talking about that fuel booster, how cold that thing is.
It has to be cold because I guess rocket fuel is what?
Yes, I don't know what the temperature is, but
nitrogen or something.
Yeah, but you're going to have all this stuff falling off. But here we go, all the warnings, all the things that went unheeded, you know.
Yeah.
In the end, all these people be fired probably.
It's interesting that they wanted to continue the program because the program makes us look good. But on the other hand, they didn't want to spend a lot of money on it. So.
Yes, you can't blame those guys, really. Mm. They'll end up probably being fired, and I don't know. But
some of them, interestingly enough, actually said that they were fired for piping up and trying to warn the space program that was going to happen. See Saddam speak in his interview from Britain's Channel 4, which will be translated and played on 60 Minutes 2 tonight, during which Saddam says, I haven't got any friends in Al-Qaeda, and it's not like it'd be easy to hide chemical weapons, not like aspirin, can't just put it in your pocket. So there goes that accusation. Rumsfeld couldn't help but blurt out a little of his own sentiment about it when he heard that yesterday. So he had his press conference and said,
It's just a continuous pattern. This is a case of the local liar coming up again and people repeating what he said and forgetting to say that he never, almost never, rarely tells the truth.
Too bad that interviewer didn't just pop him off right then and there.
No,
he had him right there, huh?
White House says, hero. Yeah. White House says they don't much care that there's no smoking gun. Okay. They know he's got chemical weapons. And Colin Powell is on his way to prove it now. In about 15 minutes, he'll be before the UN at their headquarters in New York with pictures and sound. CIA intercepted messages between Iraq scientists and other military types discussing how to hide things. You can tune in and see for yourself. They're going to cover it live at 10:30.
Did you read your news magazines yet this week, Trudy?
No, I just got Time yesterday, and I don't get news. I'm going to change that, though.
Time yesterday had a story about Saddam going into exile. And how Bush didn't really want that.
Oh, sure he doesn't, because then he's still out there. And he still has supporters, he still has his...
Nobody does anything in exile.
Well, you'd think he would accept anything to get this guy out of power. Because, again...
He wants to take him out. That regime out.
I think he
feared that he could maybe continue to try and pull some strings. But if he's in exile, then obviously people are watching over him, I would think. I mean, Idi Amin is not exactly a powerful...
Is he still alive?
Yes, he is.
Is Noriega still alive?
He's fishing and playing his accordion in Saudi Arabia, I think.
And Noriega's still alive?
Yeah, he's in jail, though.
They all,
It still seems to me if you put Saddam in exile,
hanging together,
it's still easier to get him.
You know, put him in exile, and then, give it a couple of years, and when he's out in the backyard having fun, pop him off.
There are a few lives saved by putting him in exile.
Yeah.
Well,
even Bush did eventually concede that this would be a better option, but, I mean, his hatred runs so deep for Saddam Hussein, he didn't even want him going into exile.
And he'd love to wrap up what his father couldn't complete.
Didn't he sort of grow up or come into his own hearing that your dad kind of did?
Yeah. And the damn thing that is, remember, this war could be launched and all hell break loose, and Saddam gets away.
I never thought of Trudi. Is that a possibility in your mind?
That he gets away?
Had you ever considered the fact that Saddam Hussein could literally squeal away like Osama bin Laden?
Yeah, because he will put his 11 impersonators on planes going in different directions.
Can you imagine?
He'll be one of them.
I never considered what a disaster that would be, though. I mean, that would be an absolute disaster.
Because that's the whole point, to finally
to get rid of this guy.
Bitch. Yeah.
And here you'd have the body bags coming back, and this guy's still somewhere in Tora Bora.
Exactly. And that's what's going to happen.
But I never even considered that.
That is a major headache. Thinking about that?
Yeah, I don't even like to think about that.
I was thinking about you the other day saying you hate people who are so on one side or the other, and they absolutely know what the
answer
is.
No tolerance for the other side, because I think both sides have, I think they're pretty solid arguments on both sides.
I feel the way that I think he needs to be disposed of, and I don't care how, and I really wish they'd get down to it.
I don't want to hear about the guy anymore.
I don't either, and I'm just amazed at some assassination team hasn't taken him out by now,
I keep worrying, though, that somehow they're going to let him sort of stay there, and then he's going to make his little kingdom, control all the oil, and you know how gas prices have gone up this week, about 20 cents.
Herderbird is just seen a bitch
huge.
About it.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, it's not just for me. It's not because I don't want to pay that much more. I think that the entire city of Detroit would be wiped out by that.
No question. And they were talking about, too, during the Gulf War, that the auto industry in Michigan was a disaster. Mm-hmm. It took a year to recover.
And the predicting is going to be that it's going to be that way again. And now the intelligence moles are saying that they are hearing more chatter between the people who they know are terrorists that they surveil, leading them to believe that they're getting ready for the retaliation if we attack in this country and outside of this country.
Which is scary.
Tonight, Jenny from the Block Granholm giving her State of the State speech, acknowledging that we're in a tight spot, but cheerleading with the message, think positive. And
I love that choice of words. That was in the paper, that her cheerleading message. I thought, oh, God, she's got to be really flinching reading that.
Greatness through challenge. That's what we're all about here. Meth lab busted in West Court Apartments in Windsor, an upscale complex right across the street from the Windsor police. We've been sort of keeping an eye on it for about a year, and then they raided it the other day, only to have an oh crap moment when they stepped inside because there was chemistry everywhere that was pretty explosive. They say that this stuff, had it all been cooked, would have cooked up about 9,000 hits, which they figure would have come here.
And that's right across from the cop station?
Yeah.
I can't believe the nerve. Jeez.
Well, maybe they just figured if they put it there, nobody'd suspect that they put it there.
Who would be stupid enough to set that up?
$11 million for her latest Queen of Mean activities, Leona Helmsley, wasn't convincing enough to a jury that decided that she was, in fact, liable to pay $11 million to the guy she fired for being gay. She says she fired him for being on dope and leaving sex toys laying around his hotel room and being unqualified. And then they exposed her net worth. You know, Leona Helmsley is worth between $3 and $4 billion.
Right?
These little settlements, no big deal to her.
Yeah, well, she's pretty outraged by it, though, because it exposes her wealth to potential robbers or killers.
Who have it all under the mattress? Come on.
Kidnappers and all that.
Who would try to kidnap Leona Helmsley?
I know, what a miserable experience that would be.
It'd be just, bitch!
Hispanics are angry at NBC for the new TV show Kingpin. They say it portrays them in a negative light, drug dealers, murderers, and unpatriotic, while black TV viewers don't watch reality shows, except for Rack Factor. Young black guys like that, But they don't like them so much because they don't think that they're diverse, that it's mostly white men and white women.
Hey, there's always a black guy on there. Just kidding.
Well, you think everybody could laugh at the stupidity of the whites?
You know, I disagree with that because I've seen shows where I see that the population is over-reflected in terms of minorities, and it doesn't make me want to watch it any less. Like, The Real World has, how many black people are in The Real World now? Three?
Yeah, usually.
There's only eight people.
Yeah.
The population's 15% African-American, so that's 38.5%.
American Idol is pretty,
Idol
pretty
is
equaled out, isn't
it? Huge
It's, I think it's very reasonable in terms of...
That's real.
What about NASCAR? You like NASCAR?
Yeah, you have every... That's a melting pot.
NASCAR. Do they have any black viewers?
No, I don't think they're a great deal on that.
Sure.
black people in NASCAR.
If you ever get involved in NASCAR, it's like tasting a fine wine. Once you taste fine wine, you don't want the $3 stuff.
I'm with you.
Tomorrow night on 2020, we knew Michael Jackson was out of it, but the question is he criminal? And Santa Barbara Prosecutor's Office, the DA's office, actually is thinking about maybe going in there, kicking down a few doors, because according to this information, chilling stuff that Martin Brashear, who is the BBC reporter, came up with.
I know that there are people in the United States of America, lawyers, who believe that his actions should result in the children being removed from him. It's an incredibly difficult judgment to make. I think what you have to ask is whether it's right that somebody with so much financial power should be able to have people within his home, within the boundaries of his own property, and nobody can enter in to check that it's safe, to check that things are appropriate. In this country, people are already saying that just would not be allowed.
You'll probably end up in his bed just like the rest of them.
Yeah, I'm talking about that. Yeah. How this 13-year-old kid was in his bed.
So I would think he's almost asked for a search warrant, really, with the things he said in the last few days.
Yeah, I know, it's outrageous. None of the stuff about healing cancer.
But then by then he'll have it all hidden and cleaned up.
Ugh.
Here, you know, here's just a little snippet of it. Can you tolerate it?
Yeah, okay. Sure.
Him talking about going to the zoo and how horrible it was because his kids couldn't get any zoo time without people pestering them.
What about the trip to the zoo today?
I love going to the zoo, even though it's difficult. It's like pandemonium, but as long as I get to see the gorillas, I'm satisfied. I love the gorillas.
Didn't Prince get poked in the eye?
Did Prince get poked in the eye? No.
He's okay.
He's okay, yeah.
The children were under enormous pressure with people all around.
Yeah, but I know, it's sad, but they were, the first day of birth, we had covered them. There was like helicopters flying around the hospital and satellites two blocks down the street.
But wouldn't it be easier for the bodyguards and for your nanny just to take the children?
Or their mother!
Rather than have to go through what they went through today.
No, because I can't take that chance.
And
it is her fault because something is happening. Those kids are total weirdos now.
Yeah. So he's worried about the children. He has to be there to protect them. And yet, look at the god awful things he may be doing to them behind closed doors. You know?
Well, hey, it's going to be a ratings windfall for ABC.
The ratings are going to be huge.
And Lorenzo Lamas turns up again. He is going to be one of the judges of Are You Hot? On ABC. Trudi Daniels with Front Row Radio.
All right, Drs. Pierce and Cole. It's not too late to start the new year with a new look. Call today. Find out about breast enhancement, liposuction, and tummy tucks. Check them out on the web at piercemd.com, P-I-E-R-C-E-M-D.com. We got a boogie. We'll leave it a gratuitous rock star. Thank you. Are you ready?
Ready.
Thank you, Detroit.
Thank you, coolness aside, I'd like to say thank you.
Thank you, Trudi.
Say it!
Thank you and stuff.
Thank you, Jesus!
All right, show's over, folks.
Thank you, Detroit.
Hey, thank you. It's a beautiful thing.
Thank you, media.
Talk to you later. Bye.
Thank you, and God bless you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. We have to thank you for that.
Well, thank you very much, Drew and Mike.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much.
Well, thank you.
Thank you again.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thanks for everything.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you for coming.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and God bless America.
Bye-bye, son of a bitch.